Alright, starting from today, I will have two microphones. One.
My name is Choi Wong-bae, and the new title is Meyer Share Sold 80% the most on record on blockchain. So it is yesterday's article, and the news says that stock price of Australian department store chain Meyer Holding Ltd was the most on record. The stock price went up by 80%, and it is quite shocking because Meyer's profit have been going down since 2010, and there is no other positive news about this firm, and so we can say that there is no reason for price to go up. And one more interesting point is that Meyer is among the 10 most shorted stocks in Australian stock market according to Bloomberg.
Excuse me, could you write down the name of your stock on the board?
I picked this news because this article shows exactly how short selling affects market in various ways. So, at first, short selling must have made the stock price go down, or at least affected the price to go down. But once the market price go up, the short sellers fear that they might have to pay more to buy back the stock made. Stock price go wrong. So this situation is called market squeeze as far as I know. I think the stock price will go down eventually because it went up based on fear, not based on facts or other positive news. So therefore, my recommendation is to sell this stock right now.
Okay. Price change, can you write down over there?
Today?
Yeah, I want to do price change about 80%, is that right?
Yes.
18%?
Yeah.
18, okay. Right. So the phenomena is called what? Short squeeze.
Short squeeze.
Okay, short squeeze. So some of these short sellers may have to unwind their position. Now, any questions? I covered similar story. Please raise your hand.
I have this question.
Yes.
Is Meyer Holdings?
Yes, Meyer Holdings Ltd.
So was there any kind of news? Why did Meyer?
At the first time.
Yeah.
So it was just. suspicion that someone might have been engaged in this rice. And I read that there is no other specific reason.
Okay.
Then at the first place, how did you find the article about minor movements?
It was just about short experts saying the short selling effect.
Just about the soaring of this stock.
Yes. Why it's so low?
But you couldn't find any reason for that.
The expert said that someone in Australia was engaged, but I do not know. I do not quite know this guy. So.
Any other comments? Now, typically when the price jumps, right, by about 18% or something, it will naturally come into the radar screen of any traders. Naturally, it will draw attention from individual investors and from the media, news media as well. Okay, so somehow there is some positive feedback. Okay, individual investors watch their news, and the news cover this kind of stock with short squeeze, and then individual investors jump into the bubble somehow more, and then feeds into exacerbating the situation. Anyway. Any other comments? Otherwise, let's give him a round of applause. Thank you. Do you have questions?
Yes.
Yes, please.
Despite the appearing, so the stock price today is declining, but I know that Meyer Department Store is Meyer Department Store contract with America Department Store eBay. They embrace high technology to their department store, so they are now famous for VR market. So they are considering their market share and technology. I think that selling my department stock is kind of some immediate because
too fast.
Yeah, too fast because their technology and department stores location is high, so what do you think about
it? So my thought was that it was in quite risky situation because, as I said, it is the stock that many short sellers are engaged even though they are good news. And it went up 18% yesterday, so it was my suggestion to sell, and I didn't know the positive news about it.
Okay. When did you get that news about the eBay thing? Was it yet the same time as he did, or
no.
Before?
In January?
January.
Yeah.
Okay. So that was quite some time. Good. So it's a disagreement. You're supposed to disagree somehow. Let's give him a round of applause. So next person. Okay. Coming. Competing people over there. They keep raising their hands. Which one should I choose? I mean, okay. Please do the gaibaibo again. One more time. Sorry about it.
Gaibaibo.
One more time. Go ahead. Instead, you have the microphone.
Bother
him. Your name?
My name is Yi Hiu. Okay. And I'm going to talk about Snap, a company called Snap.
Have you ever heard about Snapchat? Snap is the mother company of Snapchat, and they did IPO on March 3rd. So their initial price was $17. And price soared right after their IPO? Well, it's highly because their underwriters. Underwriter means IBs that participated in IPO process. Am I right, Professor?
Yeah.
They're like, you know, Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley. So these two companies, they marketed Snap as really attractive company to invest. So that made expectation like this. So it went like $27. But right after that, other IBs, except for these underwriters, they all said it's overvalued. So this went like this. And well, there's a regulation for 25 days. For 25 days, underwriters cannot issue research reports. So it means analysts working those two IBs cannot issue any report or suggestion. Well, right after 25 days, it was yesterday. Yesterday, these two companies made reports to buy Snap. Right after that, this went up like this, about 4.5%. But when we think about they are underwriters who actually participated in IPO process, it means there is some bias among their reports. So I recommend you to buy this, sell this stock at this point, because I think they are pretty overvalued and their PSR ratio is way too high. It's like 60 or something. So I think it's really overvalued and it's good time to sell these stocks. Thank you.
Okay, Snapchat, right? Any different thoughts?
Yes.
Question?
So he says the underwriters will make a report that will over they will make the take positive reports then uh-huh. the price go up and other investment banks will write reports that will make the price go up. What are the incentives for that? Because do the underwriters have the stock or why would they buy positive and why would they write?
Well, okay, underwriters. They, as I said, they marketed this stock to investors. And if analysts in these IBs make opinion disagree with initial marketing, that affects badly to these companies because it makes
inconsistency
between bank analyst.
Wait, isn't that the $17 the initial price? Isn't that the price they were marketing?
Yes.
Any other comments, please? You have a microphone there, so you have the first.
Thank you for your lovely presentation. I was just wondering, you said that the company experienced good start at the beginning, but some people pointed out that it's overvalued. And I was just curious on what basis, on what evidence did people have when they said it was overvalued? Was the P/E ratio too high compared to the industry average?
Actually, we cannot use P/E ratio because their earning is minus.
So what variables or what factors
are you going to think? Some say it's PSR. As I said, it was like 60 or something.
PSR means what?
Price to sales ratio.
Okay, thank you.
And compared to other cases like Facebook, when Facebook did IPO, its PSR was about 10. So it's 5 or 6 times much dangerous.
Any other thoughts, please?
Yeah, I just first and then move on to you.
Thank you for your presentation. I would like to ask you about other prospects, I mean, promise prospects about the company. Actually, when I was meeting with my foreign friends, they really like to use Snapchat. And actually, in Korea, the popularity is not really good as before. But what about foreign countries? The popularity maybe become more.
As far as I know, yes, that's right in some point because it's really popular among North America and Europe, but, well, the main source of Snapchat's revenue is from advertising, but their advertisement market share, mobile advertising market share, is only 1.3 or 4. So it's not that high market share among the world. I would say it's not that attractive.
Okay. Your thoughts, please.
I have a question about price going up at the point. Like people trusted underwriters report at the point, and why people do not trust underwriters report at this time. What makes the difference?
So, well, as I said, for 25 days after IPO, there is no report from underwriters. There cannot be. That's the regulation. So people only can see other IBs reports. So they all said, sell, hold, like this. So perception went bad after price went up.
Actually, that's a very interesting and intriguing question. IPO, talking about IPO, there are some mystery. People still don't know why the heck is happening. Okay? IPO underperformance, that's the thing. Starting from day number one. This is day number one. And day number two, starting from day number two, it keeps on going down. Not just Snapchat, but Facebook, Twitter, or most of these IPOs on average, okay, underperform over 3-year horizon. We don't know why. We still don't know why. Okay? If you can do some kind of research in that respect, that will be a huge contribution to the literature. Okay? Also, why is there a jump? Somehow by industry convention, right? You do the valuation of IPO and then knock off the price by 8% or something to make it more attractive to buy it. You know? But above and beyond, it just goes on, jumps up. There's some positive sentiment going on. Okay? People are excited to buy it. But we still don't have perfect explanation of all these phenomena yet. Okay? So that's a very good discussion to do that. Let's give him a round of applause. Big subject, finance. Right, you have those microphones over there, right? Keep that, please, and bring it back later on at the end of the class. Now, lecture two is something we are going to cover today. But, okay, lecture two, right? Page number. Page number. Covered until this part, if I remember correctly. We are working through discounted cash flow method. For that part, the first thing to take care of is the discount rate. Okay, discount rate. then the starting point of our discount trade is that, well, the opportunity cost of capital, right? Opportunity cost of capital should be at least as big as the risk-free rate. Because I'm taking more risk, I want to recover more than what the risk-free asset gives me. Okay? So our required return should be at least as big as risk-free rate and some risk premium. And in capital asset pricing model, this should be in this form, beta times equity risk premium. What if this is not a stock but a bond, right? Corporate bond or some treasury bond. Well, simple thing as well, RF plus some default premium, right? Default premium or credit risk premium. It's a premium as well, just a different kind of risk we are looking at, okay? Corporate bond, some any companies can go bankrupt anyway, so we want to charge a little bit of default premium. Countries, AAA country, no default premium. But AA, single A, all those countries have default premium, and we've been going through about how to compute this default premium using different methods. Also, I mentioned a little bit about corporate bonds. Can we think about beta of corporate bonds? Yeah, theoretically, I mean, some people do that. Beta of the bonds will be very, very small. 0.3 or 0.2 kind of, very small. It does not move together with the market too much. But you can think about, you can reinterpret into beta framework, okay? But the key idea is whatever required return should be risk-free rate plus some risk premium. That's it, okay? And then various ways of getting this default premium was presented last week. Okay? First, you can look at the CDS spread, and then second, look at government bond spread relative to US dollars. Three is that look at credit rating of your country. If it is not AAA country, they would have some credit spread or default spread relevant to their credit ratings. Okay. So those three approaches, we talked about it. Talking about this credit ratings of different countries, you can always look into this website. Okay. Basically, you can Google search credit rating of any countries. The thing is, the credit rating changes infrequently, every quarter or something. These rating agencies are kind of lazy. They are not, you know, changing credit rating day by day basis, only quarterly basis. Also, credit rating agencies, we have three of them worldwide: S&P, Standard & Poor's, Moody's, and Fitch, IBCA. First two are Americans. The last one is British. Commonly, they are slow in adjusting their credit rating, upgrade or downgrade. Number two, they heard. They move together, okay? They're lazy in a sense, right? And then they're slow to adjust it. And once anybody changes a credit rating about a certain company or country, the other two move together. Ah, yeah, we downgrade together. Okay? They heard. Why do they? But that is partially why when a certain country credit rating, our credit rating in Korea in 1998 was downgraded once, twice, three times, together with the rest of the people over here, they were moving together. So when bad things happen, it happens, I mean when it rains, it pours, right? So that's the nature of this credit rating agency work. Now, this is a chart about all different countries' credit rating. We can look at China, AA minus, and then where is Korea? Oh, here's Japan, single A plus. Where is Korea? South Korea, double A, right? And you may say, hooray, this is better than Japan, single A plus. One of the rare periods previously, you know, our credit rating was never better than Japan's. But recently, the situation changed. You can kind of think of it as 인생역전 kind of thing. But don't feel happy too much yet. And you have to think about why Japan's credit rating is lower than ours. Why is that the case?
Because their growth rate is lower.
Growth rate is lower. GDP.
They suffer the depression.
Okay. Long time depression. Yes. Lost decade, they say.
I read some news. Japanese people don't spend money about the consumption, so
okay.
They make their economy can't grow.
Okay. So they don't spend too much money, right? Any other thoughts? Why is that? I saw your Japanese book over here. How do you pronounce this one?
Sekai.
Right. So, what's your opinion? I mean, what's your thoughts about this?
It's the debt to GDP ratio, maybe that's
concerned. Debt to GDP ratio. Did everybody hear that? So the debt burden, okay? Relative to their country's economy, the GDP, how much they earn, right? Versus how much they owe to the older generation. Okay? Growing, aging population is a problem. And that makes you stop and think, wait a minute, that's our story. 10 years from now or 20 years down the road, that's gonna be us, like, you know, me, retiring, 65 or something, hopefully. And then you will be, you know, taking care of our generation, right? So that's why they have a low credit rating. Non-trivial issue. Always the credit rating for the country is about the debt burden relative to GDP. How much debt can you afford? US, double A plus, by S&P, but the rest of the guys say triple A. So there is some, a little bit of disagreement, okay? And that's that. Any thoughts here? Alright. So we talked about the risk-free rate in nominal terms. Let's switch a little bit to real risk-free rate. Of course, we are going to come back to nominal risk-free rate later. But real risk-free rate, okay? Right. In some cases, you may want risk-free rate in real terms rather than in nominal terms. For example, if your country is suffering from hyperinflation, okay? Well, you need to get to the real rate. To get a real risk-free rate, you would like a security with low default risk AAA, and a guaranteed real return. Treasury inflation index securities, I should have said. Inflation index securities offer this kind of combination. In January 2017, I get a question. The yield on a 10-year index treasury bond, okay, fixed bond, was 0.5%. Which of the following statements would you agree? A, this is the real risk-free rate to use if you are valuing US companies in real terms only. B, this is the real risk-free rate to use anywhere in the world. Okay? It's a kind of an open question. Actually, this is assuming, you know, if you assume frictionless global capital market, okay, if the money can move from one country to another country, okay, we without any transaction cost, like FX cost, or money transfer, wire transfer cost, all those things. Plus, if there's no regulation about foreign capital moving in and out, okay? Then the real risk-free rate in the US or should be the same as the real risk-free rate anywhere in the world. That's the idea, situation, economists dream about. So it can be ubiquitous everywhere. Okay. That's the answer. Now, of course, I will show you. Maybe I will show you this slide right now. Capital movement from one country to another. Okay. The governments regulate a lot. Okay. They welcome foreign capital coming in, but they hate when they move out. Blaming, that's hot money, you know. So there's some restrictions or some of the limitations, and which is costly. But so that leads me to a little bit of this slide here, which means foreign investors, right? Foreign investors, also short sellers as well. But how is it perceived in mass media? Okay. I'm not going to test you on this one, don't worry. It's not on your slide, it's just the fun facts that I just presented to you. Okay, just 3 minutes. Media sentiment to foreign investors, right, foreigners. Is it more negative compared to average crypto or positive? Okay. And then the words they say in the news article, is it more negative or more positive? Okay. So for that part, I tried this news article. I collected 3 million news articles in Korea since 1990 to 2015. And each and every news article, I can count the words, how many words shown up, right? That's what you do as an MIS major. Anybody who likes the MIS, please raise your hand. I'm a big data guy, please. Come on. I'm not going to talk to Professor Yeonggong Chang, Yeonggong Young. Please. Courageous, please. Hey, yeah, there are one. Yeah. So, if you like big data, right, this is one of the ways you can do. Count the words of news articles. How many words, right? Out of that, how many negative words shown up minus how many positive words shown up? So it measures percentage-wise how much critical was that? Okay, criticizing was that positive means or criticizing negative means so forth. Welcome. Okay. Now, very simple test, right? The news articles with foreigners in it, kind of 외국인. And the news articles without foreigners, okay? Words in it. And the difference in negative tone, right? Difference in the tone was statistically very significant. And it's foreigners covering, okay? Is more critical, more negative coverage. So whenever they say foreigners, 외국인, these are the 경제 news or economics news, right? They seem to cover using more negative words, okay? I think it has something to do with the capital flow, public opinion about foreign capital flow, and that the government may take action depending on it. How about short sellers, right? Short sellers, we've been talking about this short selling, right? We need short sellers. We should not demonize short sellers because we need them for market efficiency to make a balance. Okay? How is the public opinion on average, okay, about short sellers? Any economics news articles with short sellers in it versus no short sellers story. As it turns out, it seems like it's more statistically significantly critical. Whenever they say short sellers, you can see the public sentiment about price manipulators. and then there are like top 20 kind of things, and then they just criticize. You can quantify that kind of sentiment. MIS majors, if you want to do it, go ahead and do it, right? This is one of the ways. Of course, there are some more sophisticated ways to do it, but this is a starting point, actually. You can do it and improve it. Now, real risk-free rate, I told you about it, with capital flow, if it is free, right? In an ideal world, you just need one real risk-free rate. This rate of US dominate everywhere. Risk-free rate when valuing real currency, as I said before, friction is capital market, not. Real risk-free rate should equal long-term real GDP growth of, in that country. The government can promise to pay interest as much as the long-term GDP growth rate, nothing more. Okay. And then risk-free rate in local terms. Okay. Now we are getting back to nominal rates here. Okay. This one, nominal rate. Okay. When there is no risk-free entity. Okay. When there is no risk-free entity, we already studied. We just need to figure out the default spread of that country. Right. Subtracted from the treasury rate of that country. Alternative way is using interest rate parity, IRP, in your international economics 101. Okay. So the idea is this. Well, you start from here. We need a timeline, okay? Two different countries' timeline. You start over here today, day zero. And here's an example between Thailand and Singapore, okay? Singapore, they have risk-free entity, the central bank, monetary authority, and then their treasury, they're AAA, okay? Thailand, unfortunately, it's not AAA, emerging market country. Now, the idea is that using interest rate parity, we want to figure out the true risk-free rate of Thailand. The true risk-free rate, Sun Chiran, true risk-free rate. How do we get there? Well, let's use foreign exchange market. Okay, foreign exchange market. And then another thing to use is Singapore's treasury rate. Okay? True risk-free rate of Singapore. You can observe it, but you cannot observe the true risk-free rate of Thailand. So what do you do? Starting with a certain amount of money in Singapore dollars, you have two choices, okay? One choice is keep your money in Singapore treasury and then get compounded return, risk-free return. At the end of the period, you convert the amount into Thai baht at the forward rate. Forward rate is a kind of a promise. Okay, promise that you made with the counterparty. 10 years later, I'm going to change one Singapore dollar for 61.36 Thai baht. That's the contract that you make with the counterparty. 3도 거래. Okay, 10 years from now. How can we imagine that? Well, there are some markets, futures and forward markets. That's one way of doing it. Repeating again, put your money in Sing dollars, keep it for 10 years, keep it at your Singapore treasury, and then at that stage, convert it at forward rate of 61.36. The other way around is, today you exchange at spot rate, today's FX rate. Why is it spot? On the spot, right? Yeah, on the spot. Spot rate, 38.1 Thai baht per Sing dollars, and then keep it at the treasury, not a treasury rate, but if there should be any risk-free entity in Thailand, let's keep it over there, keep our money. If there should be any risk-free entity, of course in reality there's not, but there should be, then what we get at this stage would be identical to what we've with in this route number one, right? This way around or that way around should give me the same amount of money, okay? Route number one, this is risk-free rate at Singapore dollar, 10 years compounded, and then exchanged into Thai baht at forward rate of 61.36. That should be equal to 38.1 Thai baht converted today, and then invested in a hypothetical risk-free entity, if there should be any of them, and then compounded over 10 years, that's this amount. Okay. Equate these two. Okay. We know that the risk-free rate in Singapore is 5%. The only unknown is this guy, the true hypothetical risk-free rate of Thailand. One unknown, and we have one equation, so we just have to solve it, right? So how do we solve it? Take 38.1 to the other side of the equation by dividing. And then this ugly term is just route number one over here. Make sense? So then one more thing to worry about is that we raised it to the power of 10 because it's 10-year compounding. 10-year compounding. Just take 10 square root of the both sides. And then don't forget there's 1 plus, so just subtract 1. And then you'll get 10.12%. of Thai baht risk-free rate, okay? That's a hypothetical risk-free rate, I mean, true risk-free rate, if there should be anyone, okay? That's not the same as the treasury rate of Thailand. That's not. Treasury rate of Thailand would be bigger than this guy because Thailand is not a AAA country, makes sense? Anyway, so that's the idea over here. And then you see, one more thing to look at is that the exchange rate, forward rate, they're different. Seems to be Thai baht over time. The investors seem to anticipate that the Thai baht will be devaluing a little bit, depreciating a bit more over 10 years, right? So that's the thing you have to look at. Okay. So that's the nominal risk-free rate computation. Now, risk-free rate, here is a test, okay? We talked about different currencies, risk-free return, okay? And there is no risk-free entity. Here's a question. We have a Brazilian company, you want to value it in a US dollar, okay? US dollar. And which of the following should be your risk-free rate, okay? A, the interest rate of Brazilian real denominated long-term bond issued by Brazilian government. B, the interest rate on a US dollar denominated long-term bond issued by the Brazilian government. C, the interest rate on a US dollar denominated Brazilian Brady bond, partly backed by the US government. D, the interest rate on a dollar denominated corporate bond issued by Embraer. Embraer, by the way, that's the Boeing kind of company, Boeing airplane, right? Jets, right? Engines, right? In Brazil. And then E, the interest rate on a US Treasury bond. So the answer is? Who has the microphone over there? Yes. The answer is? You're valuing in a US dollar. Very simple word. Any other answers? Any other answers? We don't have Joseph policy over here. 모르겠는데요. I don't know. The answer is E. Okay? E. Notice that you're valuing in US dollars. Okay? Consistency rule, okay? Consistency rule. In which currency are you valuing it, okay? And then value your, the discount rate should be the risk-free rate in that currency, okay? US dollar value, US treasury rate. Ah, the business in Brazil. And isn't it more risky? Well, we're going to take care of that later on in your the exchange rate later on. We'll take care of it. Okay, final stage. Don't worry about that. Okay? Discount rate, consistency rule. Follow your currency that you're valuing at. Okay? Why do risk-free rates vary across currencies? Simple answer, inflation rate. Okay? Of course, there's a friction in the capital market, so that the real risk-free rate may differ a bit, country over country. But if it is a frictionless capital market, still there will be some inflation difference going on. Some countries suffer from financial crisis. Holy cow. And some countries suffer from big inflation. Some countries suffer from prolonged recession, like this. Recession, deflation. One more test of this free rate. On January 1st, 2017, the 10-year treasury bond rate in the US was 2.45%. Now, it troubles your mind. Well, looking back in history, this free rate used to be like 5 to 6% on average, okay? Today, it's only 2.5%. That troubles my mind, you say, because, yeah, value should be cash flow, discounted at relevant cost of capital. And we know that this guy is this guy, right? And if this guy is very small, this guy will be small as well. Which means this guy will be?
Over.
Right. Wouldn't we, if we use this kind of low rate, wouldn't we inflate this guy too much, overvaluing? So, what's your answer here? A, replace the current 10-year bond rate with a more reasonable, normalized risk-free rate. The average 10-year bond rate over the last 30 years has been about 5 to 6%. B, use the current 10-year bond rate, take the number from the market today and live with it. And then, but make sure that your other assumptions are consistent with the risk-free rate. Part C, I don't know. Okay? So, part A, please raise your hand. Be honest, please. Part B, please raise your hand. Part C, please raise your hand. Okay, honest guys over here. I don't know if you guys. Anyway, answer is part B. Okay? Take the number from the market today. Okay? Don't take historical average when it comes to risk-free rate. We're going to take the average in risk premium setting or later on. But for now, risk-free rate, live with what you pick up from the market today. Okay? Why? Why? First of all, you want to take the perspective of the market investors today. That's why you want to pick the number from the market today. Second, you just have to be consistent with the rest of the inputs. Rest of the inputs, what do you mean? Well, growth of the cash flows, right? You have to think about why the risk-free rate today is so low. Okay, why is it so low? Because the economy is so gloomy. Okay? There just doesn't seem to be any growth potential, especially in Korea. So that's why it is small. Okay? But that means this future expected cash flow, these guys are also small in the first place, okay? And the growth rate will be small in the first place as well, okay? They are small altogether, so that it will not be or inflated or something. So just be consistent. Be okay with what you do. But here's the magic. No matter how hard I argue this point, in your final project, you will choose A. And then take the average of a historical risk free rate and get some points off. Okay? There will be some people who do that. Rest assured. Okay? Mistakes. Okay? Part B is the answer. Remember that. Some perspective on risk-free rate. Historical time series chart of risk-free rate is shown with blue line graph. The bar chart is a decomposition of inflation rate and real GDP growth rate. And you can, you know, just by eyeballing it, you can see that your risk-free rate, okay, moves very well together with the inflation rate, okay? And then real GDP growth rate also affects your real risk-free rate, so it moves together. Negative interest rate is something now you have to worry about, okay? This is an extended question of the previous question, low risk-free rate, 2.45%. Take it from the market today. What if it is not just 2 but negative number? What does it mean? Negative interest rate. Who wanna keep the money? Keep my money, I pay you something. Is money a trash? Keep my money then pay you more? It's kind of a very strange situation is going on because of the recession, extended prolonged recession. Now, how can we take care of this situation? Well, clear answer, live with the number that you pick up today, okay? Negative risk-free rate, fine, use it, okay? Hey, negative risk-free rate, can I use it? Well, what are you afraid of? You're not making your cost of capital negative, right? Why? Because this risk premium will be huge, right? What do you mean risk premium being huge? Recession is a time when you are more risk averse. More risk averse, premium will be higher. Positive, big number. So that this guy will dominate this guy. Okay? Negative number, okay, just use it. Fine. Okay? I'm gonna ask this question in your final exam or Japanese risk-free rate. Shall we use it or not? If you're valuing it. Japanese yen terms, yes. Okay. Right. So that finishes our discussion about lecture 2. We can move to lecture 3. What is this about? Okay. Lecture note 3 is about finally risk premium. Okay. Equity risk premium. But before we move,
just said the risk premium always is a positive. Mm-hmm. But if recession comes, can market return be much lower than risk premium?
Right, good question. The risk free rate, the risk market return, right? We will get to that part in today's class or next class. And we will talk about something called implied premium, which makes this thing bigger instead of smaller. And in that respect, historical premium would be something you'll be worried about. Okay, this guy, using historical premium, it will be an average over a prolonged period of time, not just today, or just 1 year period. Okay, many periods, which makes it, you know, almost impossible to make it negative. Right? Good question. Right, risk. It has to do with your risk aversion. When you go to implied premium, you will see it that premium increases when the recession hits. Okay? So, watch out for that. Now, so, market risk premium, which is ideally, conceptually, your expected return on the market investment, market portfolio investment, relative to risk-free investment. By investing in this cost market, how much should I expect to get more compared to 국고채 투자 or the treasury investment? Okay, that's the idea. Now, historical premium is one thing to learn for the first part. The second part we're going to learn about implied premium. Okay, this is self-explanatory. I already said it. Now, everyone uses historical premium. If you, you know, go to the industry and your boss will say, bring me, you know, the cost of capital for this kind of company and that company, and you use you know, historical premium as you find it from the Bloomberg terminal. Here's the thing, the historical premium is a premium that stocks have historically earned over riskless securities. Basic idea over here is that history is our best guess for our future. Okay? Hopefully the history will repeat itself. But good luck, we never had Donald Trump kind of crazy person over there. We may be living in a new regime. Okay? In that respect, historical premium may be useful. There's a limitation. Practitioners never seem to agree on the premium. It is sensitive to how far back you go in history, because we want to look into history and see if there was Donald Trump kind of crazy person. Okay? But our extended history in stock market goes about 100 years or so. Okay? If we go back, if you can go back like thousands of years, of course, Emperor Nero is there. We never had this stock market at that time. So that's fine. Okay. What happened, you know? We just don't know. And then whether you use T-bill rates or T-bond rates as your standing over here, relative benchmark, this will be. It makes a difference, okay? You will see it. Whether you use geometric average or his arithmetic average will affect your numbers over here. Because we are looking back in history and taking the average excess return of the market, how do we take that average? Shall we just divide everything by n? Okay? That's arithmetic average. Or shall we assume some kind of compounded growth, assuming you put your money 100 years ago and kept it in the market and then see it today, okay? I don't know whether the money is like over here or over there, okay? For example, Austria, okay? Habsburg Empire. So I have to sound more like what? Arnold Schwarzenegger. Habsburg Empire. Like 150 years ago, this was the biggest, I mean, they had one of the biggest stock market, very successful market. If you put your money over there and then waited and did not touch anything, just gone down like this. Okay? Why? First World War, they were beaten up like crazy. Second World War, even more. And then there's. Luckily, I mean, if you put your money in the U.S. stock market, anyway, geometric average is something you just need two data points. Starting point and ending point, and then you are assuming a compounded growth, exponential growth. What is the compounded growth rate for this? That's this guy, okay? Of course, there would be some noisiness as the history turns out. You could be like, going like this, okay? Don't care about this and just take one, two observations, and figure out that justifies this growth, compounding growth. That's the idea of geometric growth rate. And they say, you know, it is more consistent if you are long-term investors and putting your money over there and forget about it, and then 10 years later you pull out. That's the thing. This guy takes care about, you know, all different changes over here. Okay? And then each periodical return, combine it, and then divide by n, number of periods inside. Arithmetic average, right, and geometric average of your return premium, right? That premium is shown over there. For arithmetic average, you can think about stock market return relative to T-bill return, okay? 3 months T-bill, short-term investment. Alternatively, you can think about stock market performance relative to T-bond return, right? Long-term investment, right? Different time horizon. Yes. And then on your vertical axis, you see different sample period. Okay? Starting from 1928 to 2016, longest period the textbook author came up with. And then he showed alternative sub-sample period, which is about 15 years of history. And then this one is about 10 years of history, okay? Now, what do you see? The historical average premium, okay? It is almost like 8% for the first longest sample period. And if you subtract T-bond returns, right, the T-bond rates, then it is a bit smaller, okay? Of course, because T-bill rate is a bit higher than the T-bill rate. And then as you move down over here, you will realize that the equity premium changes over time. I'm not necessarily saying it is decreasing uniformly, because here you see a lot more increase. Okay. What's going on over there? Well, your sample period matters. Your sample period matters. Okay? And then 10 years data, okay, is a bit noisy. Too noisy, right? Don't use it. Okay? How could you be so sure your future will be similar to what you experienced over past 10 years only? Okay? Maybe 50 years, maybe about 100 years, okay? Then you will be safer in predicting the future. Well, how can you say that you will be safer or you will have more precise estimate? Okay? More precise estimate about equity risk premium. You look at the standard error. Standard error is about the noisiness. Okay? You go back, go one more slide over here. Standard error. Okay? How dispersed is your estimate of the return premium relative to the number of observations, which means, what's that? You remember this formula for standard error? Standard deviation over square root of n, okay? As you increase the number of observations, this precision improves. Number of observations increases, the whole number decreases. Distribution gets tighter. And which means you look back longer in history and study more in history, you can have some better idea about the future. Okay? So that is it. Now, so message is try to go back in history as much as possible when you use historical premium. Then geometric average, why don't we have standard error? Because we just needed two data points, no noisiness in between, okay? No standard error, fine. That's it. And then, be consistent in yourself about using the risk-free rate that you subtract from. If you are long-term investors, subtract the bond rate. And use preferably geometric risk premium. It is closer to how investors think about risk premium over long periods. And the periods of trusting the past, okay? Looking back in history, if you're, you know, there's a limitation there. Nothing is perfect in finance anyway. Everything will be criticized like crazy anyway. Okay? You're supposed to criticize, you're supposed to disagree, you're supposed to argue, right, in finance. Now, noisy estimates, I told you, right? Even with long period, or time periods, right, the risk premium that you derive will have substantial standard error. For instance, if you go back to 1928, and you assume a standard deviation of 20% in annual stock returns, you have arrived at standard error greater than 2%, right? Now, can I go back a little bit over here, right? Two slides. You actually look at this one. Talking about the noisiness, right? If you follow this way of arithmetic average, where you subtract T bond rate, the risk premium turns out to be about 3.6%. If you go back only 10 years of history, okay? But that's a noisy period. We had huge financial crisis, 50% of the market value disappeared, and then crazily popped up, which made this standard error even bigger than your premium itself, okay? So if you're going to test with this reason, statistically significantly positive, and then he says, okay, this is too noisy, right? At least you want something smaller than your premium. That's that. Survivorship bias is one more thing you have to think about when you consider risk premium survivorship bias. What do you mean survivorship bias? Well, the market index that we use, right? Market index that we use for RM is only for the successful companies that did not go bankrupt, okay? The moment the company goes bankrupt, it's out of the index return. Well, not all companies succeed. Usually, out of 100 companies that did IPO, maybe 20% of them survive, okay? 80-20 rule. Eat and tire, it's not just for your karma thing. It's almost, it works for every aspect of your life. Survivor. If you look at the only successful 20%, you will be hugely mistaken. 5 minutes left. Yes. 5 minutes left. Now, survivorship bias. So, historical premium will be overstating, okay, the performance of the market. At some point, there is something very interesting research about equity premium puzzle. But as it happened, IPO puzzle I told you about today, and then another puzzle in the finance is about equity premium puzzle. Okay? Why do we have such a high equity premium? Okay? Was the question. Okay? Because if you do the math, and then if you follow strictly economic theory, then the market risk premium may be about 1/8%, which is that right? 0.125. We are not talking about 12.5%, but this is what the theory says. If you're reasonably risk-averse as what we call the rational person, right, rational person, the whole market, they are identical investors, okay? Then this is what the risk premium should be. But how could risk premium be this high? Maybe 8% or something, right? Huge difference. This is a puzzle, they say. Okay? Maybe we are extremely risk averse, or the data point that we looked at was a very not curious. Especially when this paper came up, actually a premium puzzle, the United States market was going through a prolonged party time. After Second World War, United States was the only country that was, you know, dominant in the capital market, capitalist world, and then very fortunate to be continuously successful. 1960s and 70s and 80s. And actually, that was the period we were lucky to export all the goods to the United States as well, right? Korea. And that's why, partially why, very important reason why we were successful in improving our economy. 한강의 기적, right? Kind of thing. It was not just a couple of leaders, not just our people, but there was a luck factor as well. Right after that paper, dot-com bubble hit, and then as we came into 2000 and the 21st century, the fortunate period disappeared. And now we are going through a huge uncertainty period. Okay? A lot of ups and downs, as you see, the huge standard error. We are getting back to our normal situation. Is this thing, is this return statistically different from zero? Not really. Which is really close to this one, okay? So, we are living in a new era compared to what people experienced in 1980s or 90s or something. Very different period. So keep those in mind. We are living in a period of uncertainty. Now, having said that, we're going to start from this slide. Thursday. See you on Thursday.